Welcome everybody to the first of our isolated talks. I'm Adam Haddo, I'm from the Architect Bookshop. We thought, given the situation that is in at the moment, it'd be good to think about the importance of community and the opportunity for us to continually keep learning with what we're doing and give a chance for everyone to come together and just learn about some architecture. We decided that the first people we would invite were people that we admired and people who we had really supported the bookshop and championed the bookshop, and Angelo, Candalepas is one of those people. We hope that tonight will bring a bit of joy to all of your evenings, give you 1 hour out of the drama that's going on in the world. And also, I think one of the things I was interested in this is thinking about local and about how even at this point in time, local is so important to the way in which we practice, the way in which we live, and what we're doing collectively. Before we start, I do want to thank though and acknowledge the traditional owner of the land on which you all sit. Our profession is one where we engage with the landscape, and so I just want to acknowledge that. So first of all, Angelo Candalepas, one of my favourite architects, has recently had a book in the bookshop about his mosque in inner city Sydney. So Angelo was a really easy decision to make to ask him to come and join us tonight. So Angelo, welcome tonight to the Architects Bookshop. While you're giving a bit of an introduction, I've cut your face off a little bit, so I apologise to everybody. But, we'll just go with that for a while because it works quite well with your screen when you're showing the when you're showing your projects. So yeah, again, Angelo, thank you so much. We really appreciate you giving us your time like this. So I'll just hand over to you. You can share your screen. Angelo, sorry to interrupt, but I'm getting some feedback to say that they can't hear you. So I'm not quite sure why that happens. So let's just try a few things. Angelo, are you there? Just wait 1 second, Angelo. Go for it, Angela. I think we can hear you now.
Can people hear me now? I don't know if they...
We can hear now. Someone, Rose McMahon, has said we can hear now, so that's excellent.
So do you want me to start from the beginning?
Yes. Yeah. Go start from the beginning.
I'm going to start from the beginning. The commission of any religious building should also be an opportunity to understand that religion. In fact, the commission for anything at all should embody an ontological exercise toward developing understandings about the relationship between concepts and people. This is the position I always take in understanding history, as for me, history is not simply a dry expression of what happened, stop and start, but a fluid expression of all things continuing. Many people think history is like a series of discrete episodes, like a TV show of unrelated events. I do not take this view. I have entitled the talk tonight, The Absence of Things, to remind myself of the absence of knowledge that is always the burden of all architectural beginnings. It seems that the point of a speech about any work after the work is completed has to do with the concept of reminding oneself of that moment of expediency where one needs to stop researching and commence the act of designing based upon something. It often takes me a long time to start any work with confidence when one considers the knowledge one requires to have to confidently commence any task of architecture. I like to think about my ancestors a lot, and Heraclitus comes to mind, that Greek philosopher who said the pandarei, which means everything flows, and it seems very applicable to history when it is obvious that everything flows in one great stream. I think I'd like to culminate on Heraclitus also because T.S. Eliot, in my introduction I'd like to culminate anyway, because T.S. Eliot in his front page to his four quartets, East Coca, as the beginning of four quartets, is prefaced by Heraclitus. It's a beautiful quote that could be read by all the people tonight, as it's all Greek to me, but for me it has enormous meaning. I like the word logos, to logu de eondos xinu zoosin. I like the word logos, which is not just logos as to mean word, but it means all the things that are in the old meaning, which are including reason and indeed plan. It's an architectural word in that sense. And the first quote then simply means, although reason or logos, the plans, are common to all, most people live as if they alone have wisdom. It's an interesting quote for me because it speaks to many things in my life presently. The next quote simply translates, the way upward and the way downward are the same, referring to what T.S. Eliot goes on to render in his beautiful four poems as the deceit of time. How I apply the first quote to architecture is that most people start the process of design with no observation and no attempt to consider, no understanding of history, nor any understanding of philosophy. Others have such a dry and dead understanding of history that they only read what happened as fact, looking for nothing beneath. I find these people's reading of history very boring. It is the history of high school, and perhaps that way of reading history is overrated. Art can change the very history that happened by subjecting us to another point of view, and architecture is the greatest of all arts in that it affects all the senses of people able to observe and enjoy its presence. I therefore used my existing knowledge of history at the time of my commission to develop a further understanding of the Muslim faith through the history of the Jewish faith, the Christian church, and the consequent history of ideas of Islam, forming the inextricable links to all these faiths as a result of understanding history. I did not stop there. I felt that we
too have something to offer in our time and to the past. And I went on to create what some would call a manualist approach to architecture. What is important to me is that I feel that more than ever I'm in this history of the world, and in this history we are able to change people's present understanding of the past. This is an image of the Seventh Ecumenical Council, or the Second Council of Nicaea. It is a retrospective image completed in the 17th century, but it depicts a meeting of the church. Now, there were many meetings of the church in the early years. The first was the meeting of the First Council of Nicaea in 325. Then there was the First Council of Constantinople, the Council of Ephesus in 431, the Council of Chalcedon. There were many of them. This was the seventh. Now, what was interesting is they came together to finish the topic of the second commandment. And that was, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. This is a great example of history, which is common in Jewish, Christian, and Islamic faiths. I've had many other examples like this that I could give, but this is a good example to show you what could be understood as an idea that affects what one can do in a mosque. I might add that the translations of all texts in various languages are indeed problematic, and Timothy Ware, in his book, Our Orthodox Faith, translates, it talks about the Hebrew, the word usually described as idol or graven images, bezel, indicating something carved, so a sculpture perhaps, something hewn. In subsequent passages of the Bible, bezel was applied to images of metal and wood, as well as those of stone, but never paintings. They came together in this formation like a courtyard, the back of which was a beautiful building that you could imagine was like St. Marco or Hagia Sophia or something important. But they created in their formation an architecture, and they created this wonderful space between them which caused for a sense of focus. They call it the ecclesia, which is actually an idea of people coming together. Whilst many scholars claim that the Islamic architecture and faith does not depict images of people as a consequence of a reading of the Second Commandment, it is obvious to me that this influential debate that tore the early Christian church apart was one which was most present in the minds of the new faith that was emerging. In 610, Muhammad began receiving what Muslims consider to be the divine revelations. Muhammad's message won over a handful of followers and was met with increasing opposition from Meccan notables. In 618, only 8 years after, he lost protection with the death of his influential uncle Abu Talib in Mecca. Muhammad migrated to the city of Yathrib, which is now Medina. The style of mosques in the 7th century were therefore based on the style of typical 7th century Arabian houses, which included a hypostyle or a columnar portion for worship, which is shown in the plan here. The columns enable the removal of walls to open up the space for worship. Around a large courtyard, which was understood to be paradise. Paradise is the same word as court or garden in Persian. And it was understood even by Louis Kahn in his beautiful speech at ETH Zurich, where he quotes the poem of Birumi, the great Persian poet. Here Kahn agrees with Birumi, who suggests looking into a courtyard was like seeing God himself. And Kahn emphasizes that he agrees with this, that what humans have created are indeed a powerful manifestation of God. Hagia Sophia was an enormous construction by Justinian. It was the temple of the holy wisdom of God. It's the former patriarchal cathedral and was completed in 532. What's amazing about it is it starts to talk about that which was also Roman. And it created technology again in the context of enabling domes to be constructed in a form of mortar and brick that was like a kind of early reinforced concrete. The jointing had ceramic pieces in its construction and could be regarded in this way as part of an extension to the Roman Empire. The dome was so large and miscalculated that it fell and was rebuilt by Anthemius of Miletus almost a century later. It was a building where even the Venetians were enthralled, and it is the burial ground of one of the great doges of the Venice Empire. What's interesting is that the concurrent time, and this is a section of it, you can see how immediate the dome is at the entry, and you can see how there's an hierarchy of form with these elements that transition between the square and the sphere called pendentives. And the interior is this incredible space of an atmosphere. These are lights that come very close to the ground such that they're manageable if they're candle. This is how I was taught about Hagia Sophia with Islamic script in my Greek school classes at a time when we were told that the world in this period was living the Dark Ages. In daytime, I was going to history lessons talking about the day, the Dark Ages, and at night I would go to afternoon Greek school talking about the 1,000 years of enlightenment when this building was constructed. But always the images were with these Islamic texts and the mosaics removed. Concurrently, another very influential building for my work in the mosque was this basilica, was San Vitale in Ravenna. It was built, strangely, at the same time as by the Emperor Justinian as the client. It was built at the same time as Hagia Sophia. It started earlier, 5 years before, and finished 10 years later, but it was much smaller. And it was one of the first places where I could find a kind of central altar. It reminds me of Frank Lloyd Wright's Unity Temple in many ways, because it talks about a kind of democratic plan. There isn't a cross in it. And when I look at what other great mosques appeared, these great works, they remind me of that fantastic house plan that we saw earlier. But always, because of the vastness of the land in which this religion was exercised, there needed to be a call to prayer from a high point. And this was required in the form of a minaret. And that was at a time, of course, when we didn't have magnified sound, but it caused for all sorts of very beautiful and creative structures such as this. The other very, and what's common when I look at that is the courtyard that is translated into buildings that have become semi-courtyard, semi-public spaces, such as this, which is the plan of St. Mark's in Venice. St. Mark's in Venice has a dome that is 28 meters wide. And when we compare it to the dome of Hagia Sophia, Hagia Sophia's dome is 31 meters wide. So it's just under. But it means this was 978 to 1092 in the years of its creation. And it means that the building was still not eclipsing the size of Hagia Sophia. But nonetheless, it was what I would call a beautiful Byzantine church. And the plan had adopted this very, very simple style of the five domes and mosaic that would rival Hagia Sophia, if you can imagine that in gold and as a floor pattern. And there's the ceiling, which I think starts to give you a glimpse of the sort of ceilings that existed that people would have been aware of at the beginning of Muslim faith, but also through early Christian churches. And this is the section that shows how carefully crafted this idea of domes is to replicate the shallowness of Hagia Sophia and yet have these bishopric style, almost Russian style tall domes from the outside. The other very influential building, which was built between 748 and 1236, is the Cordoba Mosque. And here are some plans. Perhaps they're running the wrong way. They're running from right to left, historically. Abd al-Rahman the First ordered construction of the Great Mosque, which was considerably expanded by later rulers. He did that in 748. Cordoba returned to Christian rule in 1236, and in the 16th century returned to a cathedral nave. At the same time, Hagia Sophia was being turned into a mosque by the Ottoman Empire. I would say that the Islamic faith indeed may have been more sensitive to the architecture to Hagia Sophia than this, despite the great horrors in the fall of Constantinople. Till this day, no Christian has worshipped in Hagia Sophia since the fall of Constantinople, and no Muslim has worshipped in the Cordoba Mosque since the reoccupation of Spain by the Latins. And this shows how this mosque was appropriated and in which was inserted the cathedral. At the time of creating the designs for the architecture of the mosque, I also visited Ahmedabad, having been invited to give a talk in India. And I was shocked by this beautiful mosque in Ahmedabad, 1423. It's the Jama Masjid, and it was built by Sultan Ahmed Shah. And I have to say, whenever I go to visit contemporary works where people are lauding how wonderful contemporary works are, oftentimes I find them wanting compared to the works of all time. The sanctuary is an hypostyle hall. It consists of 300 slender pillars. And the best way to show this is in the plan. They're about 1.5 meters apart. The columns are symmetrically arranged to form 15 bays across the long axis of each hall, each surmounted by a dome and connected to the next through a columned interspace. The central compartment of the nave rises up to three stories. But what's most beautiful, I think, is the space in front and the fact that there are no enclosures once you're within. It's all open, and I suppose what is very evident in this building is how beautiful an appropriation of an ancient idea they have made in the context of their own climate. And this is a section showing the subtlety of hierarchy with the stone domes. And I was very influenced when I looked at these stone domes, thinking that we could replicate them. I was also very influenced with this kind of illusion of space that exists in the cutting of stone columns, where it feels as though somewhere the columns stop and something else starts. And that was something experienced more in real life than in this photo. I can't believe when people go to Agra that they don't talk more about Fatehpur Sikri than they do about the Taj Mahal. This fort was built in the 16th century by a Mughal emperor. It is kind of incredible as a city, and this is only one part of the plan. It's the one that you see here on the bottom of the screen, and there are ways of entering that are incredibly powerful as a journey through these spaces that any Bozar plan would rival any Bozar plan. It's a beautiful series of spaces that has to do with the careful understanding of its topography, and then these beautiful moments which one walks out and looks at the landscape. But what's more beautiful, in my opinion, is what happens within, what happens with light, and how you can imagine yourself in a different atmosphere, in a different place by virtue of this. And this is a courtyard again, which is the theme of all of these buildings. How interesting that at the time of the creation of St. Peter's, we saw the fall of the Eastern Roman Empire to the Ottomans. And how interesting that Pope Julius, after Leo, failed to develop the plan of Bramante, and how many people after his work worked on that building. Moderna, I think, is perhaps the last. But what's interesting is that this space, which Corbusier more recently talked about as not as powerful as Hagia Sophia, was not as powerful, in his opinion, because of the length of the nave and the lack of proximity in the section to that experience, which we knew was something that happened in Hagia Sophia. Nonetheless, it's remarkable. And what's remarkable about it is this courtyard at the front of the space, which respects the history of all that we learned about an approach, a procession, into a layered experience. Hagia Sophia has a courtyard, so does that building. This, of course, is not Hagia Sophia. This is the Blue Mosque, which is a replica of Hagia Sophia, and it came significantly later. What's interesting is that it has subtle changes. Changes of proportion, the adoption, of course, of the minarets, but also that this space is developed and it's taken from a very beautiful idea 1,000 years earlier. I would like to talk to you about another very interesting, influential moment for me in Muslim and Arabian world, and that is the idea of navigation. The Arab Empire significantly contributed to navigation and had trade networks extending from the Atlantic Ocean and Mediterranean Sea in the east to the Indian Ocean and China. Apart from the Nile, Tigris and Euphrates, navigable rivers in the Islamic regions were uncommon, so transport by sea was very important. Islamic geography and navigational sciences made use of magnetic compasses and a rudimentary instrument known as the Kamal, shown here. They were used to observe the stars, and that navigation translated to these instruments, the quadrant that was used, arguably people say this was the actual one that Captain Cook used to come and find where we are presently. And I think that's a very important thing to remember in terms of science, and how that then translates to stars being painted in the domes of early mosques. And we too need to respect the entire history, in my opinion, of science. In this regard, we need to respect the idea of eternity in the shapes of Euclid and the sphere, but we also need to respect the ideas of navigation that enabled us to be here today. So this is the entire history in a kind of run, and all the buildings that I've shown you are shown here also. The blue are the buildings of a Christian period, and the red are buildings of mosques. As you can see, there was an enormous amount of work in layering between buildings that were known one to another. And what's important for me is to recognize that we need to understand these buildings before we can start creating something of our own. I, of course, start with ideas that stem back to an understanding of geometry. It's always the way I like to start. And so my sketchbook is full of these things that enable people to imagine what I'm thinking in my office. And my office is a place where, unlike many people would like to think, it's a place where I like to hear what people have to say. Quietly, they encourage me or discourage me. And this is a very interesting picture because it's very early in the piece. It talks about a unified diaphragm, a bit like the National Gallery or Kahn's work, but tilted up in an angle, holding a huge hole in the center. How you do that in structure is important to recognize. How that fold structures the building is important to recognize, and also how the hollowing out can actually be constructed. I imagine that there would need to be in the formwork some way of connecting the two sides, and I also imagine that these could be little stars in the later design by way of the connections that were required in the formwork to pour that piece of concrete. And this is the first drawing, one of the first drawings anyway, that starts to talk about the geometry of our site versus the geometry of Mecca. And it's interesting because, of course, the subdivision doesn't have Mecca in mind, and we need to deal with the subdivision as though it isn't a problem, but it was a problem to our site because it wasn't perfect in its bifurcation of the diagonal. And what's interesting also is, I imagine if you're worshipping, you're at a much lower place than you are if you're sitting. So I wanted to work out what that meant in terms of the geometries of the space. I wanted pendentives in the building to hold this beautiful dome up, but we didn't have that, and an antidote to that, something that needed to be replacing that was the compression plate for the base of the dome. And I trialed many options and looked at even Otaniemi by Alvar Aalto and his university stepped building, but these didn't work. And then I came to a conclusion that I needed to have simpler geometry, which was a square geometry in which quadrants were placed, and that was the end result. The other thing that I looked at was how to separate the dome from the base. And this was when we were looking at a stone dome. We saved quite a bit of money by not creating it in stone, but it's still able to be done. And what I always do is work out what dimension is right by looking at my hand. This is where you can see the stepping is a simple stepping. Every single one of those is simple and square, and then the intersecting domes. And this is where I did an idea about how to make a connection in granite up there. And it was all based upon a piece of steel that ran around, and steel is a wonderful thing in compression. It's 10 times the usual strength of concrete in compression. It's actually amazing in compression. We never really use it. So I thought we could use it there such that this gave the impression that the dome was floating. And I always wanted the dome to feel as though there was no apparent source of light or obvious source of light. This is me working out how to make make the building. And these are sketches that I like to do. And then suddenly I was asked by the client, what about the minaret? And then I thought, oh my God, I don't know how to do a minaret. And so I thought it should be here at the entry point, but I didn't know what a contemporary minaret in Australia should offer someone. Of course, a minaret is about a call. It's about a voice. It's about a human voice. And oftentimes it's magnified by mechanical means. So I spoke to my clients about what opportunities there were for a person to be up there, and they were rare. And I also imagined that if you're in this space, you needed to take care of the neighbours and not be calling to prayer all the times that are necessary. And so there's a discreet call to prayer, and I'll show you that later. But this is the minaret. I struggle with these things, and there are many drawings of how to do a minaret and how not to do it, and more drawings of how not to do it, actually. And then there are drawings, and there are crosses, and there are many crosses. And then I thought at one point we could just do a minaret that had this kind of expression that introduced you to the mosque. And I thought, what a terrible idea to not surprise people. I like it when people are totally surprised on entry, just like Hagia Sophia, which is what Korb taught us. So this was the minaret, believe it or not. I don't know if I've succeeded, but there it is coming down at some point and allowing that single plane to enter through into the building. These are the sort of detailings that I do. This is the dome oculus that was going to have a cobalt blue cross orange blown piece in there, which once we saw the space, we didn't want. This is how the air comes out. We use the dome for the air to bleed out all the time, so it's constantly open. The floor is heated with hydraulic heating. And these are the sort of details that I do. And then I say wrong, but I then say right at some point. But it means that we're constantly changing things and constantly wanting to improve. The office is just one of those beautiful places where people know that if we have to start again, it's for good reason. No one ever complains about drawing things again and again and again. And we've learned to love the pain of it, actually, because we make mistakes the first time. What I like about the doors is that this window is centered and it precludes human scale. I think human scale in public buildings needs to be carefully monitored, because we need to be very careful about how we perceive space in a public building. This is the minaret. Surprisingly, it comes downward to greet you. It's an arm that opens, and one stands here and calls to prayer. As is the case in minarets of ancient time, the person is unable to be seen because of the distance or because of the screen. But what is able to be heard is the thing that's important. This small awning that forms part of this sculptural composition enables people in inclement weather to walk in. But mostly this is a courtyard that has another courtyard here that enables a school to be created next to it in future. And this is the bottom of the minaret, which was a way simply of showing entry into the building and a kind of quietness. This is a detail of bare stone and timber. It's ambiguous as to which way to slide. This is what we call the male ablutions, which means people can come and wash their hands and feet. I like the entry to be very low in the buildings, because as you come out of the ablutions, you should feel that the entry is a kind of space that compresses, and then suddenly it's not very clear as to what the scale will be inside, and the drama of an opening is very important. And it is the detail, I believe, that people see first. The ladies' gallery sits and bifurcates the dome. It's very, very powerful in terms of the geometry of the space, but it's completely the wrong thing to do in terms of the history of these types of buildings. But I thought it was important in Australia that we did something differently, that we put the women in the center of the space and under the dome, and kept the tradition of concealment, as is the case and is the desire of my client. The bottom door is this wonderful door that can open and you enter the second courtyard. So it's a series of courtyard spaces. And here is an image looking up. If ever you are on your knees and you see the space, and one can never see the source of light, I think that's an important characteristic of that dome, and such that the chalkiness of this concrete that we selected, people in my office are, I always think they're geniuses for being able to help me, Evan and Adrian, and so I don't know how to do it myself. And I think it's important to have people that are really excellent at the kind of things that you're not good at, because people, not one person can do everything. So this is the space, and this is the women's gallery. And there are the stars. They were the things that held the concrete together, and now they release one's eye into the universe. I have a little resume of the whole thing, and what I wanted to do was remind myself of how much I love Glenn Gould's Bach Goldberg variations. He, in my opinion, is perfection on the piano, and if I can just do this little slideshow, it'll end my talk for tonight and we can do some questions. It's just about a minute. Well, that's it, Adam, and I think you can talk to them about buying my book now.
Thank you, Angelo. That was amazing. So thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate the effort that you put into talking to us about the project tonight. I wanted to ask a couple of questions while you come back on screen, while you unshare your page with us. Have a chat about the client and the process and the type of research you did getting into the project. Esteban asked a question about how much research did you do and for how long, and how did you know you were ready to start working on the project?
I think I spend my life researching, Adam, and the buildings that I showed you tonight, apart from the ones in India, and I'd already, in high school, I'd already learned about India from high school onwards. I've always been interested in knowing about the buildings. And so it wasn't so much research as revisiting in context and knowing what was important and what wasn't. I think there's a bit of reading to do in these instances, but mostly it's walking into the spaces or imagining one that needs to imagine walking into the spaces. And I have to say, I feel very privileged to have had a very sound education both in high school and at university. And much of that has to do with my interest in the world. So it's not true to say that I started researching when I was asked to do this project. It's more true to say that I knew where to go.
And so from that point of view, Angelo, sorry about the noise in my background, everybody. But one of the questions that just came up is you talked earlier about the fact that the dome was meant to be out of stone, and then it was transitioned away from stone, and you ended up building all of it out of concrete. Are you happy with that concrete outcome?
Oh, look, I'm always unhappy and happy at the same time. It's always not good enough. And there's always things that we could have done better. I have to say, I'm looking forward to the next building where we can exercise a level of dexterity in concrete, and I suppose we're doing that now. But what it means is that one should never, ever, in my opinion, be happy with what's... You can be satisfied that you've done your best, and you can be certainly satisfied that it's a fantastic job, because after it's finished, it's never really yours, is it? I mean, it's always the gift you give, and others need to be credited for it more than the author. And time shows that that's true. Society gives these buildings back to society. And so I suppose when we look at what our society does, and I say jestfully, we value engineered things out of it. The stone dome is a great pity in a sense, but also isn't it delightful that we as a profession can manage these situations such that a really beautiful alternative is always around the corner, and a creative person is able to offer that. It's always lamentable to see how people that are in the profession are oftentimes upset if a client can't afford something. I like it in a sense because it means that we have another opportunity to offer something with less means, and that is a very creative process.
I wanted to ask you just a little bit about the client and about how you came to be doing this project in the first place. And I mean, you do a lot of work in this area, so obviously they would have known your work, but I am interested in how they came across you, how you became involved in this project.
If you're talking about the Canterbury municipality, I grew up in Campsie, and I still go to church at All Saints in Belmore. But I've only done really two projects in the area, these two buildings. I won the Sulman, our firm won the Sulman Medal for All Saints Grammar School. And they discovered it, and the council basically agreed that we had done a good building, despite the fact that we had a terrible problem getting an approval for it from the council. And so we were in a way in the local press, and it was a building that was a school, and they commissioned me to do a school. The Muslim community wanted a school. But I thought, what an interesting discussion that we would have. So you wanted to do a mosque, I said, but you want to do the school first. In our church, the church came first. And isn't your faith about those things that are important first? And education is important, but I think it's not as important as faith. So we had a long series of discussions, and I persuaded them to do the mosque first and have a community first. I believe that there's a lot of buildings that are not architecture, particularly in faith, in the faith environment, where they do a lot of bad buildings. But never is it the case that for a work of architecture, whether it's a house or a public building, any public building, a work of architecture always has a social dimension. And it has a collective social consciousness in it, because that's part of what we do. We can't extricate ourselves. And the mosque is a kind of public building, unlike a school. And so they were encouraged by these words. They didn't have any money, but they asked me to speak at the function, the very first function for raising money. And what I said was the truth about my dilemma about doing the mosque. And my dilemma was that I was Greek Orthodox, and we'd always been told really not to do anything with the Muslims, and that's a terrible thing, because the Christian faith doesn't allow us to hate anyone or not be part of any community. That's not actually what is the right thing to do. And what I did was I asked Father Angelo up at Gladesville Church, who had asked me just recently at that time to do something for him, about a dream that I'd seen. About a prayer that I had. And after which prayer, I prayed for some guidance. And the week after, I got a call for a commission for the great synagogue here in Sydney. I got a call for a Protestant church that is now under construction. I got a call from Father Angelo. I got a call from the mosque, basically every faith. And he said to me, the message is very clear. And I said, what is it, Father Angelo? He said, we are all the children of God. And you cannot discriminate. And you need to be doing these buildings, and you need to pour yourself into them. And I took that guidance from him, and I love him dearly for it. And I said that on the night of the fundraiser, and everyone did everything almost a standing ovation. And it was a beautiful way of engaging with that community. There were over 1,000 people in the room, and they raised $2.5 million. Not because I said that thing, but they felt that they were part of an important thing that was happening. And I think that's a very important message for our Australian community.
Now that the mosque is built, what's the process for the school? Is the school going to happen? Is it going to be part of the growth of the mosque in this location? Like, what's the ambition of the client from that point of view?
We are instructed, as of most recently this year, that the school will commence. And we have a three-story building that is beautifully designed to match that. There were many options to change what was next door, and the council had put forward a proposition for eight stories. But Our community is a community there of the most beautiful people, and they're modest people. And in a way, the meek are the people that we should listen to more, because whilst they're not talk very much, they have a lot to say. And they're going to build a very modest school, just a primary school, and that's planned to start soon, after coronavirus.
Well, probably a good spot to finish on. Angelo, I want to thank you just to talk generally about having everybody here in the room. So at the height of this, we had 400 people listening on all at once, which I think is pretty amazing. So thank you for that. I think it's been a really remarkable talk, a really engaging discussion about the mosque. Can people visit the mosque?
Well, they will be able to soon. There's one technicality with an interim occupation certificate, and we're getting through it, but very shortly, and after we obviously have these isolation rules lifted, the bookshop is going to get people to come, I'm certain. But already I calculated around 2,000 people have visited the building, and that's before it's even opened.
Fantastic.
And most of them non-Muslim.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Angelo. We really appreciate it. Thanks for your time. We know that particularly at the moment it's challenging as a practitioner. We wish everyone out there, we hope you enjoyed it. We have another one on tomorrow night with Vokes and Peters from Brisbane, and two more next week that we will announce towards the end of this week, and then over the Easter weekend. So please come back.
This is just something fun to do, to get everyone together and talk about architecture. But we really appreciate it, Angelo, and thank you very much. See you soon.
Thank you.